There's the man, the king of Grand Prix motorcycle racing, arguably the greatest motorcycle racer of all time. I think if he wins the race this afternoon, that title will stick forever. Valentino Rossi prepares for his opening ride on the Yamaha here in South Africa. And we and about 300 million television viewers and probably 30 or 40,000 spectators here at Velcom cannot wait for those red lights to go and the race to start. Rossi, 25, 33 wins, 21 poles, 5 world titles, 125, 250, 500, 2 MotoGPs, switch to Yamaha, same old story. Can he do it again? He looks, I won't say he looks tense, but he certainly looks like he's very, very focused indeed. Not a kiss to the camera, not even a kiss of the camera lens, perhaps that would come. But I think Valentino Rossi really means business. Yeah, and Matthew, he looks a bit nervous.
He looks serious, doesn't he, Nick? And, yeah. You know, probably flashback now to his Premier Class debut here in 2000, which he made at this circuit. Very similar conditions, a huge challenge ahead of him. He's got to take it seriously. He's got to do the business out there. And really, you have to think, Nick, that he's got to get away with the leaders at the start. We've seen Rossi make bad starts in the past on the Honda, but be able to recover it. We don't know what sort of limits there are on this Yamaha. He doesn't know what limits there are to his ability on board it. And he knows that he has to go with the front guys at the beginning to make sure that he can weigh them up and make sure that he's in there at the end. Because if Rossi gets caught up, if he makes a bad start, he might find it difficult. Because guys like Sete Gibernau, who starts from second on the grid, are going to be looking to make a quick exit.
What a season Sete Gibernau had last year. It started with tragedy when his teammate DeGiro Kato was killed at the Japanese Grand Prix. But he won the race here. He won more races, pushed Rossi to the limit, and finished second in the championship. Max Biaggi, winner of the first 500cc race here at Velcom 5 years ago, now returns on the Honda, front row of the grid, four times 250cc world champion. He really has got a great chance to at least be on equal terms with his bitter rival, Valentino Rossi. But a good start to the season in those opening three races. Absolutely vital for the Roman Emperor.
Big, big race and a big, big season for Nicky Hayden as well, starting from the second row in fourth. It's a shame for Nicky Hayden that the grid's been changed, because he's only qualified on the front row of the grid before. He qualified fourth on that occasion. He's matched that performance here this weekend after a difficult qualifying session. He finds himself on the second row, so he'll be disappointed with that, but important for the likes of Nicky Hayden to get a good start as well, like Colin Edwards, and make sure that they're in the mixer when we get to that first corner, that tight left-hander at the end of the straight.
We come on to Colin Edwards, qualified on the second row of the grid in fifth place, former World Superbike champion, best finish with six, and that was in the opening Grand Prix of his MotoGP career a year ago at Suzuka in Japan, riding the Aprilia. It was a tough season on the Aprilia for the Texan Tornado, but he really looks comfortable on the Honda. And many people feel that he's going to challenge for the world title and perhaps become the only man to win MotoGP and World Superbike.
Just talking about Colin Edwards there, just alongside him on the grid now, and he did make that move from Aprilia to Honda in the off-season, and it's been a very, very important move for you, hasn't it, Colin?
Yeah, it's been good so far. You know, I've been back with a company that I know very well, and, you know, nothing against Aprilia. I had a great time, but got a lot of experience, and now we're back over at Honda on Michelins, and, you know, we're the best team.
You've been very consistent throughout the whole of the off-season, throughout the whole of the winter, putting race simulations. Do you think the race is where it all is going to come together?
Yeah, I mean, you know, we got a good setup of the race. It's just a matter of getting a good start and getting out there with the boys and, you know, playing that chess game and see what happens.
Okay, well, all the best for today, Colin.
Thanks.
Colin Edwards also sounding slightly serious there, you have to say, don't you? Usually likes a laugh and a joke on the grid, but not today. And this is the big league, and Colin Edwards is a big part of it. And Shinya Nakano on the Kawasaki in sixth place on the grid. What a performance from him, Nick. And what a performance for Kawasaki in general.
Yeah, completely changing the machine after their MotoGP debut last year. Bridgestone tyres paying full dividend. Shinya Nakano, one of the nicest men in Grand Prix racing. And in the right circumstances on the right machine, he is very, very quick indeed. Another former 250cc world champion, Marco Melandri, third row of the grid. Not a bad performance by Melandri, because they're all the Yamaha riders a little bit in the shadow of Rossi at the moment.
Yeah, but I think if anybody can benefit from Rossi, it's Marco Melandri. You know, they've been good friends. They came through a very similar progression through the 125 and 250s. And many people said that Marco Melandri was really trying to mimic Rossi in his early days, which was perhaps a little unfair. He's certainly not done that lately. He's very mature, Marco Melandri, now, and I'm sure that he'll be looking to pick up as much rider information as he can off Rossi, as opposed to the colour of his hair.
This is the man that replaced Valentino Rossi at the Repsol Honda team, Alex Barros. Very experienced Brazilian. Wretched season last year on the Yamaha, injury hit season, but don't forget, he won two races at the end of 2002 riding the four-stroke Honda. Very underrated. A fit Barros is as good as anybody. He's also a very, very difficult man to overtake. He's the demon on the brakes. He gets out there early on towards the front. He can prove a very big threat. Disappointing time for Ducati with their new machine, but just watching Loris Caparossi in action riding this bike, who's qualified a ninth fastest on the third row of the grid, is worth anybody's admission money.
Yeah, it was truly something, wasn't it, watching Caparossi. He's right on top of that bike because he's so small. He doesn't really get off either side of it. He's right on top of it, moving around. He was really battling it around the circuit, and really testament to the battle that Caparossi had to get into ninth place with that bike in the early stage of development, which it's at, is Troy Bayliss. Sadly, Troy Bayliss in the penultimate position on the grid, right down in 21st. That's not where we want to see Troy Bayliss, but unfortunately that's a reality this weekend. We'll move on to him later, I imagine. Kenny Roberts, for the time being, looking fairly happy, and plenty of reason to be happy as well, Nick.
Yeah, certainly the Suzuki seems a lot better this season. Of course, it's on Bridgestone tyres as well, and Kenny has looked very useful.
I'm down here, further back down the grid, introducing new riders in the MotoGP grid this season, and moving up British Superbike champion Shane Shaky Byrne. Shane, it's a big step, isn't it?
Certainly is, yeah. It's a long walk back from them lights, that's for sure.
What are your hopes going to be for this season on board the Aprilia RSQ?
Just to keep improving all year, you know, try and get a start here and see how we go, and maybe pick up a point or two, and then try and build on that for the rest of the year. We've got a lot of work being done at the moment with Aprilia, and you know, they're working as hard as they possibly can to make sure that everything's right for me, and you know, I'm working as hard as I possibly can to make sure I get results for them. So, you know, hopefully we're going to have a real good year, and just like I said, to get a couple of points here would be real nice, and we'll see how we go, see if we can achieve that.
Okay, as we know, you're going to give it all you've got, as you always do. Thanks very much, Shaky.
No worries, thank you.
Shane Shaky Byrne there, making his debut this weekend, the British Superbike champion, winner of two World Superbike Championship races, remember, as a wild card at Brands Hatch as well. You got a glimpse there of John Hopkins in 11th place. We move on to 12th, the outside of the fourth row. It would usually be the outside of the third row, but with the new regulations, it's the outside of the fourth, and it's Makoto Tomada who's on it. And Makoto Tomada on the Honda, Nick. Big season for him as well. His second in MotoGP on that Honda with Bridgestone tyres. Big season for him as well.
It certainly is. Of course, he's in the Honda Pons team with big sponsorship. The garage, Michelin tyres for Max Biaggi, Bridgestone tyres for Makoto Tomada. I think he impressed everybody last year on his MotoGP debut. Now we come on to Alex Hoffman riding the Kawasaki. This is Alex Hoffman's first real serious season of MotoGP racing. He's fitted in wildcard entries for Kawasaki last season, and also replaced Loris Caparossi when he was injured at Honda Pons. But a big season for Hoffman. And with Carlos Checa, it must be difficult for the Spaniard riding in the same team as Valentino Rossi, and he's in 14th place, and Valentino Rossi is in first.
Yeah, I think that Checa, though, even admitted yesterday, he's got no excuses now, because Valentino Rossi is showing everybody just what the Yamaha can do. Neil Hodgson, the World Superbike champion, of course, making his, well, it's not his Grand Prix debut. He has competed before in Grand Prix, riding a 500cc bike. So Hodgson, not new to Grand Prix, but new to MotoGP and new to the four-stroke era of MotoGP, and looking to make an impression in his first season riding the Dantin Ducati, the 2003 version of the bike that Troy Bayliss and Loris Caparossi did so well on last year. You would imagine that Troy Bayliss wouldn't mind having his bike back for today, would you?
No, you wouldn't. Poor old Troy Bayliss really is having a tough time at the moment. He made such a sensational MotoGP debut last year on the Ducati. Here, I remember in particular his battle with Valentino Rossi. He really pushed Rossi to the limit, didn't he? But he's not happy with the new Ducati. He's finding it very, very difficult to adjust to. Ducati obviously want to continue down the same line with new parts and the new bike, because probably that is the way ahead. Poor old Troy Bayliss is suffering. We've had 5 months at home. We've had some pretty miserable weather in England in that time. And me personally, I've just been waiting for this moment. It's arrived. The sun is shining. Can Valentino Rossi do it? We're about to find out. Well, it's going to be fantastic.
Watch out for this man coming through the grid as well. Superbike fans will recognise that name, Ruben Jaus, coming from 16th on the grid. He's been impressive in qualifying. He's been impressive in pre-season. Watch for Jaus in that first corner.
Certainly has been impressive. He tumbled on Saturday afternoon in qualifying. Only two fallers, him and Alex Hoffman. But got to say, impressed. Now, here's the old man of Grand Prix racing. You wouldn't think so when you see him race. 40-year-old Ulsterman, Jeremy McWilliams, the last British rider to win a Grand Prix, a 250cc race 3 years ago. He partners Shane Byrne at Aprilia. And as always, you can expect nothing but about 5,000% from Jeremy McWilliams. He really is an amazing 40-year-old as we come back to the front row of the grid. Max Biaggi, last year's winner, Sete Gibernau. And the man in pole, Valentino Rossi. Blow those whistles. We're about to get underway.
Laps of this 4.242 kilometer, 2.636 mile circuit. Valentino Rossi, the circuit record lap holder. He's also the pole position record holder now after that 132.647. He heads up the front row from Gibernau and Biaggi.
Second row, Hayden Edwards Nakano. We've got to speak a little bit quicker this year.
Third row, Marco Melandri, Alex Barros and Loris Capirossi.
Fourth row, the two Suzukis, Kenny Robertson, John Hopkins and Makoto Tomada on the Bridgestone Shot Honda.
Just over a second separating the top 12 there. Alex Hoffman in 13th on his MotoGP debut season. Carlos Checker and Neil Hodgson.
Rubens Chaus, Jeremy McWilliams and Norik Abe make up the sixth row.
The seventh row, Shane Byrne, Nobuatsu Aoki. And would you believe it, over 3 seconds off Rossi's pole time, Troy Bayliss.
And making up the eighth row in the grid, Mikhail Fabrizio riding the WCM machine. Happy to see them actually back on the grid. And we're told that Chris Burns, the Geordie from England, will ride the second machine at Jerez in 2 weeks' time. The sighting lap, the warming up lap, the lap before the action starts. This is the
problems for Norik Abe and Mitchell Fabrizio getting away there. Bayliss was also slow off the line. Fabrizio's away though, and he's going to join up with the rest of them.
Yeah, Michel Fabrizio, former 125cc rider, European Superstock champion, coming in to ride for Peter Clifford's WCM team. And good news there from Peter Clifford and Bob McLean, the co-owners of that WCM team, that they are going to contest the full season of MotoGP. It didn't look that way at certain points over the winter, but it's been confirmed. WCM are here to stay. And that is good news. So, as you said, Nick, Chris Burns joining up with Fabrizio in 2 weeks' time at Jerez. Fabrizio, the lone rider here today.
Earlier, the 125cc race was decided on the final bend. The 250cc race was decided on the final bend. We now come on to the dish at the top of the menu. It's the 28-lap MotoGP race here at the Africa's Grand Prix at Velcom. Is it the day that Valentino Rossi writes another chapter in the MotoGP history books? If he wins, he's the first ever rider to win consecutive Grand Prix in back-to-back races. If he wins, he's the first rider since the late Barry Sheen to win 4 consecutive opening Grand Prix of the season. The likes of Nicky Hayden, Alex Barros, Sete Gibernau, Colin Edwards will have something to say about that.
It's really intriguing, isn't it, the way Honda have responded to Valentino Rossi's decision to quit them in favour of Yamaha. They've got Gibernau, Biaggi, Hayden, Edwards, Makoto Tomada, all looking to beat Rossi. They've gone for power in numbers, but it's just the lone Yamaha of Rossi that's cut through them all to take pole position for this opening round of the 2004 season at Velcom. Watch out for Rossi off the start. He needs a good start. Watch out for the Hondas coming from behind him. It's going to be one heck of a race here at the Fakisa Freeway. And the MotoGP grid, for the first time in 2004, is ready to go.
The red flag is shown. When the red lights come on, as they're going to any minute now, the 2004 season about to start. The lights are on red. We're away. Who's made a good start? Rossi on the outside. Gibbono on the middle and Biaggi on the inside.
It's a great start from Valentino Rossi, something we're not accustomed to him seeing, and he's taken the whole shot at the first corner. It's Rossi who leads the way from Gibbono, and Alex Hoffman there on the Kawasaki Saki having problems, but it's Rossi who leads the way from Gibbono, Biaggi, Hayden and Edwards.
Everybody safely through that first bend. They're up to turn two, up to turn three before they break for turn five. The right-hander, Rossi, Gibbono, Biaggi, Hayden, Melandri, Edwards, Caparossi, Roberts and Barros.
Kenny Roberts making a move on Capirossi there, so Roberts now up to seventh position and Capirossi back down to eighth.
But Valentino Rossi has made the start he dreamed of. Can the Hondas stay with him? The man that finished the race at the front of Rossi last year in second place, Max Biaggi third, Nicky Hayden in fourth place. It's panning out exactly as Valentino Rossi wanted. Rossi leads the way. There we see Colin Edwards, behind him Kenny Roberts.
Marco Melandri's made an excellent start there as well, Nick. Ooh, up to fifth yes. place now. You had to fancy him, didn't you? You like when he gets a good qualifying position, Melandri, he always tends to make a good start and really dukes it out with these guys. We saw it at Phillip Island in the penultimate race of last season, and Melandri going well at the moment. Here comes Biaggi up on the inside of Gibbono. Biaggi up to second place.
Gibbono relegated to third, and the experts told me before the race, Valentino Rossi will try and break this field in the early stages. He's made the hole shot, he's got in front, and Max Biaggi knows he mustn't let Rossi get away.
We all enjoyed Valentino Rossi sometimes making bad starts last year and watching him fight through the group, but he just can't risk it this year. He's got to know how far he can go on this Yamaha. He's got to know where the limits are, and he's looking to find them on these first laps. Colin Edwards has been relegated by Marco Melandri to sixth place. Melandri, oh, there goes Edwards up the inside of Melandri as he ran it wide. So I think Edwards may have got him back. A real battle going on there between the former 250cc world champion and the former world superbike champion. And at the moment, it's the former world superbike champion, Colin Edwards, who has the edge on the Honda.
It's Marco Melandri right behind him. They come up to the boot section, little short straight, and then the right-hander. Rossi leads, Biaggi second, Gibbono third, Hayden in fourth place. Little bit of a gap. Colin Edwards still fighting off the challenge there of Marco Melandri. We then have Roberts, Caparossi, Barros, Schaus, Nakano, Abe, Tamada, Hopkins, Hodgson, Checker, Byrne, McWilliams, and Troy Bayliss down in 17th place.
Disastrous start that for Carlos Checker down in 16th, wasn't it? With his teammate leading the race, it's really disastrous stuff for Carlos Checker. This is the season of reckoning for him. You have to think that if he can't cut it with Rossi as his teammate on that Yamaha, he's going to be in big trouble with young Spaniards coming up through 125 and 250s. Carlos Checker up against it and way down the field. But at the front, it's the three men who topped the championship last year. Valentino Rossi in first place, Max Biaggi in second, Sete Gibbono in third, in a reversal of the way they finished. Of course, Gibbono, the runner-up in the 2003 World Championship and the winner of the race here last year.
We ride with the world champion, riding for the first time on the Yamaha. Right behind him is bitter rival, 250cc world champion four times, Max Biaggi. 26 laps to go. The gap, 0.177 seconds between Rossi on the Yamaha, Biaggi on the Honda. Then we have Sete Gibbono, Nicky Hayden, Colin Edwards and Marco Melandri.
The pace is absolutely electric at the start of this race, Nick. I can tell you that the previous lap record here was set by Valentino Rossi with 133.851 on the Honda last year. He's already beaten that, or he's certainly getting close to it. Oh, Max Biaggi, sorry, he's beaten it. 133.690 for Max Biaggi, a new circuit record from the Roman Emperor. And it was Valentino Rossi who'd set the fastest lap until Biaggi stole him behind him, really closing in on Valentino Rossi. And this, a really interesting head-to-head between the former Honda rider and the former Yamaha rider.
That's right, they've swapped places, haven't they? It's taken a season to do it, but the Yamaha leads the way. Biaggi second, Sete Gibbono in third place. Rossi's tried to break the field. He certainly hasn't achieved that because Biaggi and Gibbono have come with him. And how Max Biaggi would like to be. I think out of any race they've ever raced each other in, this is the race he'd like to beat him in. And he certainly is hanging in there tight with 25 and a half laps to go. We thought it was going to be good. It is good. Rossi leads. Biaggi second. Gibbono third. We just got a glimpse there of Nicky Hayden, I think, coming under pressure from Edwards and perhaps Melandri.
Don't forget, Nick, as we were saying at the start of the broadcast, Honda have got a six-strong field of factory riders taking on Rossi, who's really a lone gunman, really, for Yamaha, and still looking for the man who's to take them forward. They're still looking for their lead rider. It didn't emerge over the pre-season testing period. They're not sure if it's Biaggi, if it's Gibbono, if it's Hayden, or if it's Edwards, and they really need somebody to step forward to the back. And at the moment, it seems to be Max Biaggi. He wants to establish himself as number one. He wants to be the man to beat Valentino Rossi. And he wants to be the man that Honda helped to beat Valentino Rossi, their former son.
24 and a half laps to go. What a start to the season. Rossi still leads the way on the Yamaha. Right behind him on the brakes, Max Biaggi, the yellow Honda. We now arrive at Max Biaggi, almost the back wheel of the Yamaha and the front wheel of the Honda touch. Biaggi is hanging in there, I wouldn't say comfortably, but he looks like he really means business. Chibinau in third place, Hayden fourth, Colin Edwards going well in fifth, Malandri, Caparossi, Barros, Roberts and Rubens Chaus going very well in 10th place. Further down the field, John Hopkins in 14th place, in 16th place Neil Hodgson, 17th place Shane Byrne, 18th place Jeremy McWilliams and 19th Troy Bayliss.
Max Biaggi putting real pressure on Valentino Rossi as they come down the back straight. Biaggi up on the inside and Biaggi leads the way on the Honda. Does he keep his line? No, he runs it a little bit wide now. Can Rossi fight back? He's not close enough and Max Biaggi hangs on to the lead. Here comes Valentino Rossi though in the tight section of rights that brings him back into the final left-hand corner. Here comes Sete Chibinau into the equation as well. He says, I'll have a bit of that. Max Biaggi goes from the lead to third, back up to second in the left-hander that brings him into the start-finish straight. Well, he can hardly keep up here. It's like a 1-2-5cc race and long may it continue.
Oh, what a battle it is. Sete Chibinau arrived like somebody in a computer game, suddenly on the screen. Where's he come from? It's settled down just for, probably 5 seconds. Rossi leads, Biaggi right behind him. He's riding over Sete Chibinau. Chibinau had the audacity to go past Biaggi. They've got to be careful, these Honda riders. They're not going to race too much against each other.
Ruben Schaus comes into the pits. Problems for the Spaniard in his debut MotoGP race.
Problems for Max Biaggi as well. Runs it wide. Sete Chibinau up to second place. Biaggi on the brakes. Has a look at the inside again, though. But Chibinau hangs on. And Biaggi pushing so, so hard there to get back at Valentino Rossi has paid the price. Look at Rossi smoke that Yamaha. We haven't seen anybody do that on the M1 before. Rossi's been doing it in qualifying. And he's already doing it in the race. Getting that Yamaha sideways, spinning it up at the back and putting some distance between himself and the two chasing Hondas.
Giles has retired from the race. He's gone. He's walked out through the back of the pits. He's out of the Africa's GP.
Thanks very much, Gavin. That was just the incentive, I think, that Valentino Rossi wanted, because he's opened up a little bit of a gap. These Hondas are going to be so careful as Biaggi goes up the inside of Chibinau. Biaggi back into second place. They almost touch the yellow and blue. They've swapped paint jobs, but Biaggi back into second place. Chibinau third. They've got to be careful not to do too much of this. They're going to wear out their tyres and they're going to give the Yamaha the advantage if the Hondas keep racing like this against each other. You will feel now that Biaggi wants to really establish himself in second place and get back after Rossi. But they're using up a lot of rubber to do that.
You can't blame Max Biaggi for doing this, but they're playing right into Rossi's hands. This is what he wants, not only today, but for the rest of the season. He wants these Hondas to really battle each other, take points off each other, take positions off each other. And if he can just stay consistent, pick up wins when they come available, he has a serious chance of retaining that MotoGP World Championship and becoming the first man ever to defend the title on two different machines, or the first man rather since Eddie Lawson, but the first man to win consecutive races on different machinery in the history of the sport. What an achievement that would be.
But he hasn't pulled away, has he? He did open up a bigger advantage when Biaggi and Chibinau came together, swap paint jobs, but Biaggi's got right back at Rossi. We ride with Max Biaggi. He's closed right up on the man, his bitter rival at the front, riding the Yamaha, Valentino Rossi. 22 and a half laps to go. What a start to the MotoGP season. The men you want at the front are there. Rossi leads, Biaggi second. Chibinau probably just taking a little bit of second wind before he goes back and has another go. Behind them, Nicky Hayden in fourth place. Colin Edwards fifth. Marco Melandri sixth. Seventh is Loris Caparossi. Eighth is Alex Barros. Ninth is Kenny Roberts. 10th is Shinya Nakano. 11th is Makoto Tomada. 12th is Norik Abe. 13th is Carlos Checa, 14th John Hopkins, and in 15th place, the current World Superbike champion, Neil Hodgson. But all eyes are on the front. The two Italians are at it once again. Rossi leads Biaggi.
Well, it's an incredible story, isn't it? The last person, I'm sure, to lead a race in the MotoGP on a Yamaha was Max Biaggi, and here he is riding the Honda behind Valentino Rossi, having complained so many times while he was at Yamaha that Rossi had the better bike. And here is Max Biaggi. A couple of years ago, you couldn't have envisaged this situation. It seemed impossible that Max Biaggi would return to Honda. It seemed impossible that Valentino Rossi would ever leave. But here we are at the start of 2004, Rossi leading the way on a Yamaha, Biaggi chasing him on the Honda. and Sete Gibernau doing his level best to stay in touch with these two mercurial Italians.
Top end of the circuit, round the right hand of the second part of the boot. That's turn five, where Rossi made the mistake, you remember, 2 years ago on the last lap. Ran a little bit wide, the tyres were really wearing out. Then Turo Acaro, who was his teammate, went on to win the race. In fact, Rossi's only won one Premier Class race here at Velcom. Gibernau won it last year, Turo Acaro the year before, Rossi the year before that. We've had five separate winners in five Premier Class races here at Velcom. But looking at this, all these three have won one of those races. You think it's going to be between these three. And Biaggi goes up the inside of Rossi on the brakes. Biaggi retakes the lead of that series of right-handers that brings him back towards the start and finish. Rossi trying to get back up the inside on the Yamaha. But this time, Biaggi doesn't run it wide. Biaggi leads the way. Rossi in second place. Gibernau third. Here comes Rossi again, trying to get up the inside. He's determined not to let Biaggi get away. He looks behind. Gibernau not quite as close as perhaps he thought. Round the left-hander, into the start and finish straight. 21 laps ago. What a race here we have at Velcom. And Max Biaggi leads from Valentino Rossi, Sete Gibernau, Nicky Hayden, and Colin Edwards, and Marco Melandri. In fact, not Marco Melandri.
Alex Barros there
Barros
in sixth place.
In front of him.
Yeah, Alex Barros and Loris Capirossi as well, Nick, on the Ducati. So Capirossi up to seventh, Melandri down to eighth. Colin Edwards sitting firm in fifth place. But, well, you just have to think there is Colin Edwards, in fact, in fifth place. Now Biaggi has got past Rossi. It was almost an action replay of the previous attempt, wasn't it? At the end of the back straight into that fast right-hander, Max Biaggi got underneath Valentino Rossi, but this time Rossi wasn't able to respond. Now, can Max Biaggi take advantage of that? He had good rhythm during all of the seconds, of the sessions during qualifying, especially yesterday afternoon when they were refining the race setup. And you always thought that if Biaggi got out in front, he had a good chance of setting his own rhythm and escaping. Now Rossi faces a real challenge to stay in touch.
20 and a half laps to go. Biaggi leads the way from Rossi. Gibernau in third place. There is Sete Gibernau at the back of the picture as they come onto the back straight, fastest part of the circuit, then into these difficult long right-handers, turn 11, turn 12. Well, they have the brake hard for turn 13. Here goes Rossi again. He really is tight to Biaggi. Has he gone up the inside? Has Biaggi run it wide? Rossi back in front. Oh, the Emperor leads, sorry, the Doctor leads away from the Emperor as they break for the left-hander. Rossi is not giving up this fight. The Yamaha leads from the Honda.
It's amazing to see Rossi beating Biaggi on the brakes there. The Yamaha had so many problems last year on the stability in the brakes, and Rossi's just gone through him on the brakes. Just shows how much work they've put into the Yamaha and how much it's changed this season.
Yeah, big changes all round for all Yamaha, starting from that first test session with Jeremy Burgess and Valentino Rossi in Sepang. Here we'll see that move again. As you say, Gav, so stable there on the brakes. And Yamaha had lots of problems last year, particularly in stability in the corners and the balance of the bike in general. But Rossi and Burgess have worked so hard to rectify that. They've changed the firing order of that inline four-cylinder engine, and that's just improved the power delivery. And all the changes all over the bike to the chassis and the engine has all been geared towards just making it more stable, more rider-friendly, and quicker out of the box. And that's what we've discovered here. Valentino Rossi said all the tracks that they've tested at so far have been tracks he's liked. He's had full days or 3 days to get the bike working there. Here they only have 4 hours during qualifying, and it was important that Yamaha had a bike that he could make fast from the very first session. He did that. He's been the fastest man in every session here this weekend, and he's the fastest man in the race so far. Valentino Rossi in supreme form under the South African sunshine.
Yeah, Biaggi very close indeed. Both of them kicked up a little bit of dirt as they came onto the back straight. These tight right-handers, so important to get good braking and good drive. A little short straight here, then it's the left into the start and finish. Rossi still leads the way. Biaggi second, and Gibernau in third place when they cross the line. 19 laps to go. This opening round of the MotoGP World Championship. It just does not get better than this.
We've lost Kenny Roberts off the timing screen. Just trying to work out from Suzuki what's happened there.
Yeah, Kenny Roberts was lapping well in around 10th place, but we've lost him. That's a big disappointment. And it seems to me, Nick, as Sete Gibernau is just getting a rhythm together now and making sure that he doesn't lose touch with these two guys. They threaten to break free, but Gibernau is hanging on. The gap between Biaggi and Gibernau at the moment, around 0.8 of a second, and it looks to me as though Gibernau might be just closing it down even more.
Look at Rossi backing in that Yamaha. As you said, nobody has ridden the Yamaha like that since they came back into MotoGP racing with the inline four-stroke. But Rossi can do it. Biaggi having nothing of it, hanging very, very close to the rear wheel of the Yamaha on the Honda. Just get a glimpse there of Sete Chibana as they come down the slight incline. 18 and a half laps to go. Rossi trying to get up the inside, Biaggi trying to get up the inside, doesn't quite do it, but he's letting Rossi know that he's not going to have it all his own way.
This is the key part of the circuit, Nick, the fast right-handers onto the back straight. This is where we've seen Max Biaggi make his move on the previous occasions that he's overtaken Rossi in this very corner that we see now on board with Rossi. It's a fast right-hander. It comes up towards the Gielskop, turn 13, a tight right-hander where Rossi had his revenge on those occasions. Biaggi this time closes right up on him. They get onto the gas and then it's onto the brakes into turn 14, the final turn of this 4.242 kilometre, 2.636 mile Bakisa Freeway, and it's Rossi who still holds the advantage. Kenny Roberts, in fact, has just walked past our commentary window, Gav, looking rather dejected. So he's on his way towards you in pit lane, I can tell you.
Yeah, it's a real shame for Suzuki. They're all stood around. No one really knew what had gone on with his bike, but they've been going so well all weekend. We have to remember, though, that in warm-up this morning, they had a problem and the bike stopped. So it must be a similar problem, something like that. I'm pretty sure it will be. A real shame for Suzuki, who have pushed on so much, just like the Kawasaki in this off-season.
Now we run down through the field and John Hopkins, his teammate, in 13th place. Neil Hodgson, the World Superbike champion, in 14th. And Troy Bayliss picking up some points, another former World Superbike champion. But we ride with Max Biaggi. You can't take your eyes off this battle at the front. Rossi wrestling with the Yamaha. Biaggi right behind him. He's pushing the Yamaha. He's pushing Rossi to the limit. And so far, at the moment, with 17 and a half laps to go, Rossi has responded. How long can he respond in this way? You really fancy that Biaggi's going to have another nip at him, I would say, within the next lap. And I think it's going to happen as they come round these double right-handers into the back straight. When they come into the right-handers now at the end of this straight, Biaggi's going to try and nip up the inside of Rossi. Not quite close enough. And Chibanao now looking very comfortable in third place.
These three guys are class above the rest of the field at this first round so far. All lapping in the low to mid 133s. Chibanao slightly mid to high 133s, but the rest of the field are in the high 134s. So they're lapping at over a second a lap quicker than the rest of the field. It's absolutely electric. Rossi and Biaggi, both former winners at this circuit. Rossi with the 500 Honda in 2001. Biaggi with the 500 Yamaha in 1999, our first visit to Velkom. So they both know their way around this circuit. We're looking at three Velkom winners here. The only one missing is Gary McCoy. There is Kenny Roberts in pit lane. McCoy, of course, winning the first round of 2000, but the other three winners here in the last four seasons of MotoGP racing in South Africa have been Rossi, Biaggi and Chibanao, and there they all are. It's no coincidence.
Just had a quick word with Kenny as he came down pit lane. He didn't really want to talk to us because he didn't know what had gone wrong. The bike just stopped, so the end of the race for him.
Yeah, bad luck for Kenny Roberts. He's looked good in pre-season testing. He's looked good in qualifying. I'm sure we're going to see more of him before the end of the season. Just got a glimpse of them talking to his dad, Kenny Sr., and Irv Kanemoto, of course, back in the Suzuki camp and with his Bridgestone cap on. Good to see Irv Kanemoto back, and again, Biaggi pushes Rossi to the limit. They come onto the back straight once again. Rossi just holds firm round the double right-hander, that double Uncini curve. And now, along the little straight, it's not a little straight, but it's not particularly long, about half a mile long. And then they have the brake for the right-hander that tightens up and tightens up. Biaggi not quite close enough this time. You get the feeling perhaps Biaggi also just taking in a little bit of air and just getting things sorted out for an attack, because we're not even halfway through. Our voices are running out. Everybody's on their feet going absolutely crazy. We've still got, just over 16 laps remaining of a 28-lap race. It's a long, long way to go. It's a long way for the bikes. It's a long way for the riders. It's a long way for the tyres.
Yeah, you're right there, Nick. A long way for the tyres. A lot of the guys at the front there running the new Michelin 16.5-inch front tyre. Something new that's been developed by Michelin this year. It's got a much bigger contact patch. That half-inch diameter difference makes such a big difference to the feel of the front end. Colin Edwards brought that over from Superbike. We're all using it out there. And there's lots of compounds out there that just try to deal with the bumps and the heat of this circuit, and especially those three bends going onto the back straight. So much heat gets generated through the right-hand side of the tyres that the right-hand side of those tyres will be a bit harder than the left as well. So lots of interesting things. And the interesting thing about the Yamaha is we haven't seen it over race conditions yet. We're going to see over the next few laps how it's coping with these conditions.
It's going to be so, so interesting over the second half of this race, because really you look at Valentino Rossi, a specialist when the tyres go off. We can see his rear tyre there just coping with the bumps and the heat around this Fakita Freeway. It's so notorious that underneath of it's almost like a honeycomb with all the gold mining that's gone on here in the past, and slight earth tremors have led to this bumpy surface as we watch Biaggi just come close to him again. But it does have such a taxing effect on the tyres.
Mitchell Fabrizio into the pits. Not sure whether it's going to be the end of his race, but a sad day for WCM. Yep, Fabrizio in and off the bike.
Oh, the end of the end of the road for Mitchell Fabrizio and Vulcan, but as I was saying before, it's going to be a real clash here of styles because Rossi, the specialist when the tyres go off, he likes to have the back moving around. But we haven't seen the Yamaha ever used like that before with the likes of Checker and Biaggi, who've been the main guys who've been using it. Whereas Biaggi doesn't like that so much. He likes to ride a more finer style. He likes to stay on the same line, more of a 250 style. He's never really been keen when the tyres go off. Whilst the Honda is really the bike that suits it the most. So really the guy with the biggest compromise out there in terms of the second half of the race could be Seto Gibernau. He's got the Honda, he's got the bike to do it, he's got the riding style to do it. And we could see him come on strong in the second half of the race because both Rossi and Biaggi could have some problems, especially with the rear tyre.
14 and a half laps to go. A couple of occasions, Biaggi's almost got alongside Valentino Rossi. Lets him know he's there. Pushing him as hard as he can. He's trying to push Ross's tyres to the limit. There's no doubt about that. Seto Gibernau still looking comfortable in third place, but a little bit of a gap he's got to make up. Of course, he got involved in the battle for second place with Biaggi and Rossi's. Biaggi again almost comes alongside Valentino Rossi. They're into this series of right-handers now that bring them onto the back straight. And I think this is Carl Fabrizio, isn't it? Yeah, the WCM man out of the race. He looks disappointed. His MotoGP debut, and disappointing for WCM, but great to see them back in Grand Prix racing. I'd sit back now if I was in that garage and watch this race. This is going to go to the checkered flag. Probably the two best MotoGP riders in the world at the moment, battling it out. Bitter rivals. They're not friends. No Christmas cards between them. And they're battling it out where they should do, out on the racetrack.
Yeah, he doesn't have it too bad, really, does he, Michel Fabrizio? He saw the first half of the race from the track, and he's going to watch the second half of it on the TV because this is where it's really going to get interesting. We've reached the halfway stage in the first MotoGP race of the 2004 season, and it's panning out better than we could have possibly imagined. Valentino Rossi in his debut ride on the Yamaha, riding like an absolute legend, which we all know he is, to hold off the challenge of his great rival, the Roman Emperor, Max Biaggi, who so desperately wants to beat him here and so desperately wants to be the man that Honda turned to defeat Valentino Rossi and retain that world championship crown at their Japanese factory headquarters. And Rossi would do like nothing better than to take it with him across the road to Yamaha.
Just had a word early on, didn't you, Matthew, about how they got that Yamaha to change its performance, especially going into the corners. Basically, when Rossi got to Yamaha at the first test, he said, we need to make this Yamaha work like a Honda. And that's what they've done. They've taken the inline four, they've changed the firing order, they've made it work a bit more like a V, so it's got that grunt when it's coming out of the corners. And that's why we're seeing Rossi being able to control that bike much more. Yamaha gave Rossi a choice of four engines. He said, this is the one I like. And now we've seen that. It's gone on to Checker and Melandri because they've been using it in testing now, and Rossi really is comfortable with his machine now.
Just over 13 laps remaining to those long rights that bring them back towards the start and finish area. They tighten up, but Rossi, the Yamaha, looking very stable through here. Biaggi working like a demon behind to stay with them. Now they're into the left, that brings them back into the start and finish area. When they cross the line, 13 laps ago, this opening MotoGP race of the season. What a race it is. Valentino's Rossi board doesn't really have to say too much, does it? He knows he's in the lead. I think he knows how close Max Biaggi is just by the noise of the Honda behind him, and he knows that Honda noise very well indeed.
Well, Max Biaggi's done his level best to let Rossi know where he is, hasn't he? We've almost forgotten about this battle further down. Alex Barros has made a sterling effort to come through from eighth place. He's gone past his teammate Nicky Hayden now for fourth, and Barros on that number four Honda, making a return to Honda, remember, after riding for Yamaha last year, making a direct switch virtually with Valentino Rossi. He's now leading round his new teammate Nicky Hayden.
Good ride by Barros. Still not 100% fit, I don't think, after a real injury hit season, but he could be the big surprise of the season. We see Troy Bayliss in 14th place, Shane Byrne in 15th. I'm looking to see where Neil Hodgson is at the moment. Is he out?
I think he's just gone on that lap, Nick. We'll wait for confirmation from Gav down in pit lane.
In comes Neil Hodgson into the pits now, just as you're saying it. Hodgson comes into the pits, and it looks like the end of his race. So an awful start to the year for the Dantin Ducati team. Hodgson and Joust both out of the race. The World Superbike boys not having it good here.
Kicking up dust, both the two leaders as they run it a little bit wide, running onto the back straight. Rossi still leads the way, but Biaggi is a lot closer this time. I think he's probably had a little bit of second wind, worked things out, and now he's going to start chipping away at Valentino Rossi, as he has been for most of this race. On the brakes, into the left, into the start and finish straight, 12 laps ago, and there is a very, very disappointed World Superbike champion, Neil Hodgson, out of his first MotoGP race.
Lap 16 of 28, and the three previous winners at Velkom, the three top men from the championship last year, are leading the way by a good stretch now. Rossi, Biaggi, Giovinazzi just hanging on to the back of them. And then further back, we've got Barros. We're on board here with Nicky Hayden in fifth place. For the moment, Nicky Hayden's taking the honours for the Stars and Stripes. He's leading his compatriot, the Texas Tornado, Colin Edwards. Edwards currently in sixth place. And Nicky Hayden, well, you might have expected to be further up here, but he'll certainly take some satisfaction from beating Edwards. There's no doubt about that. Edwards in his first ride on the Honda there on that number 45 machine. And there it is, the confirmation of Alex Barros' progression. He went back from eighth on the grid to ninth on the second lap, but he's gradually worked his way through up to fourth place. His race pace a little bit quicker than Nicky Hayden. So, oh, and we've got a faller there. That's Kawasaki Alex Hoffman. And that looks nasty, but Hoffman, it looks as though he could be okay, still moving, which is always a good sign. But Hoffman down on his the start of his rookie campaign in MotoGP.
Shinya Nakano, his teammate, still continuing. But Hoffman, he crashed during qualifying on Saturday afternoon and also fell again. We're back with the leaders. This time the helicopter shot tells us the story we've known throughout the race. It's going to be close, and it's still Valentino Rossi that leads the way from Max Biaggi. Through the left, over the start and finish line. 11 laps to go between the two Italian superstars. Sete Gibernau in third place, really just losing a little bit of ground now, 2.4 seconds down on the race leader.
Max Biaggi, the fastest man on the circuit and the fastest lap of the race so far. Valentino Rossi picked up the pace and Biaggi responded. Rossi with a time of 1:33.268. Biaggi responds just 1/100th of a second quicker, 1:33.258. And that is a new circuit record here at the Fakisa Freeway. And the pace, with 11 laps to go, picks up again. Rossi picks it up and Biaggi responds.
We still have Barros in fourth place. Hayden, Edwards, Caparossi, Tomada, Melandri, Abbe, Nakano, Checker, Hopkins, Bayliss and Shane Byrne.
Some potential points on the card for Shane Byrne. We heard from him on the grid. And that would be an excellent start for him to his MotoGP career, making his debut, of course, after winning the British Superbike Championship. Hearts are pounding in the Camel Honda garage, and you can understand why. Max Biaggi has got Valentino Rossi in his sights. He's stalking him like a hunter, and I tell you what, the pace has picked up at the front, and Zeta Gibernau can't live with it. Gibernau has dropped off by around 0.8 of a second on that lap. He's now 2 seconds behind Biaggi in third place. This is going to be a straight head-to-head between the two Italians, the great rivals, Valentino Rossi and Max Biaggi, and you can bet that Valentino Rossi wouldn't want it any other way.
I'm sure he wouldn't. Cross the line they come, 10 laps to go, and of course Max Biaggi's Honda team mourning the death of their technical director Antonio Cobas on Wednesday in Barcelona after a long illness, and what a fitting tribute this is to a truly great man, a really nice man, the performance of Max Biaggi as he tries to unseat the world champion Valentino Rossi. We ride with Rossi on the Yamaha. 10 laps to go. Well, 9 3/4 laps to go. Biaggi right behind him. Sete Gibernau dropping off the pace a little bit. And Alex Barros flying in fourth place. It's between the two Italians. It's between the two biggest rivals in MotoGP racing. It's between Yamaha and Honda. It just does not get better. It doesn't get tighter than this. And who can ride the harder when the tyres start to wane? They're starting to wane now. We know that Rossi can slide the bike. The Yamaha not known for sliding, but we know that he can do it. Could they be closer? We ride with Rossi. Is Biaggi going to come up the inside or the outside? We look for that yellow fairing. I don't think so. Yes. I don't know.
As he has done on so many occasions on the Honda with Biaggi riding the Yamaha. And really, you have to say, Nick, Biaggi, he's got no excuses this year, has he?
Well, he hasn't, no. I mean, the Honda obviously is the World Championship winning machine. He's saying that he's riding the bike with the new swinging arm and the new rear section, and they haven't had much time to test it because when the parts came for his team, it was at Barcelona 3 weeks ago and it rained. It rained in Jerez 2 days after that, so they're testing. They've been testing and qualifying, but it doesn't seem like he's done a bad job in testing and qualifying, doesn't he? And he really is pushing Rossi to the limit. What a performance, though, by Rossi at the front. Even if he finishes in second place, you've got to say, it's a truly remarkable performance by the man on the Yamaha.
We're entering uncharted territory, aren't we, now, for the Yamaha. We haven't seen them go this far. We haven't seen them lead a race for a long, long time now. In these conditions, we saw with the onboard of Rossi just how bumpy this Velkom circuit is, and it really does wear out those tyres. I'm starting to worry. Rossi has looked so consistent throughout this. Just wonder if he's getting a little bit rugged around the edges, and can Biaggi take advantage of that? It's going to be a battle down to the line of that, I'm sure. But who's going to be on top of it?
Well, we're looking at Max Biaggi come through these Uncini corners, the fast right-handers that come onto the back straight. And Nick just briefly mentioned there that new swing arm and rear shot that Honda brought out during the winter. It was tested, first of all, by Nicky Hayden in Sepang. He was very, very happy with it. And then Max Biaggi inherited it at Catalunya. The idea of it is to just improve the feeling on the back end. Jeremy Burgess, in his time at Honda, has said that the bike was good from the swing arm pivot forward and not so good going backwards from that pivot. But they've improved it this year, and the idea is that it improves the edge grip on the tyres when they're at full lean like they are now going through this left-hander, and that certainly seems to have worked in Biaggi's favour. The two times that we've seen him overtake Rossi, or every time he's attempted a pass, has been coming out of that fast right-hand corner, turn 10, when they are at full lean, and coming down into the back straight when we know that Honda has got excellent power and excellent top speed. And I really think that with the tyres going off, with that extra grip that rear shock is designed to give for the Honda, it could be a real advantage to Biaggi over these last few laps.
We wait and see. 7.5 laps to go, top end of the circuit, coming into turn 5, the right-hander. Biaggi closes right up on Rossi once again, then runs it a little bit wide. The gap closed right up, then it opened up a little bit, but I think that's going to happen throughout the battle. But Biaggi, without a doubt, is sizing Rossi up as they come back down the hill. Castle curve. Now we go further down the field. And here we are. This is Carlos Checa. Carlos Checa currently running in 11th place. In front of him is Yamaha teammate Marco Melandri. Terrific onboard shots we see of Carlos Checa with the gear changing of the Yamaha, but he's gear changing for 11th place. His teammate at the front is gear changing for first place.
Yeah, Carlos Checa there just coming through the boot corner and then out of turn 6 and then up through the gears as they come through, down through turn 7 and 8. Fifth gear very briefly and then down to third for these fast right-handers that come onto the back straight that we were talking about before. So important here. This is where I'm talking about Biaggi having that extra edge grip with that rear shock. As you can see, the Yamaha working hard. Carlos Checa up to sixth gear, the only point on the circuit, and he uses it to go past his teammate Carlos Checa. Now, Marco Melandri. And did Melandri get back up on the inside there? I'm not too sure. It looks to me as though Carlos Checa has hung on. He has. They come up towards this tight right-hander, the Gielskop corner, that brings them back into the left, onto the start-finish straight, and it's Checa in 10th place, Melandri in 11th, and Shinya Nakano in 12th. But beautiful onboard footage there. And just a glimpse of the extreme precision and technique of these MotoGP riders.
Shinya Nakano riding the Kawasaki for the first time in a MotoGP race on the Bridgestone tyres. Be happy to finish in the points. His teammate Alex Hoffman has crashed out of the race. He really was the sensation, you've got to say, of qualifying when he finished on the second row, 6th fastest. Back at the front, 6.5 laps to go. Biaggi all over the rear wheel of the Yamaha of Valentino Rossi. It's hard to say it even, isn't it? All over the rear wheel of the Yamaha of Valentino Rossi. It should be the other way around. We're not riding with Max Biaggi. We thought we were earlier, didn't we? But in fact, this is this very clever camera, a reverse camera, that shows the backside of Valentino Rossi on the Yamaha. When Max Biaggi perhaps gets alongside or past him, we might just see briefly a yellow fairing of the Honda. But at the moment, blue is the colour on the track. Blue is the colour in the sky.
Incredible, that onboard footage, isn't it? When you watch these guys from these angles and we see them going around, you just can't grasp the speed and the angles that they're riding at. But when you see those onboard cameras, it just brings it home to you. I mean, even here at Velkom, which is the second slowest track on the MotoGP calendar. They're reaching speeds of 160 miles an hour down the back straight, which is only 413 meters in length. It's incredible acceleration. Just incredible that these guys can push the limits of engineering and sort of human resistance, really. But that's what they're doing, and these guys take it to the limit like nobody else, and like nobody else has been able to here at Velcom today. Valentino Rossi and Max Biaggi. You can bring as many riders in as you like from World Superbike or anywhere else. 250 world champions, World Superbike champions. It's the same story as it has been for the last three or four seasons. Valentino Rossi and Max Biaggi, absolute supreme performers. And here they are riding on the very, very edge.
Isn't it Biaggi? He's getting that Honda just to slide a little bit, isn't he? That's not Max Biaggi's style as he closes up on Rossi. He is riding the wheels off the Honda. We ride with Rossi. Biaggi right behind him. 5.5 laps to come. They come onto the back straight now. Here comes Biaggi on the brakes. Has he got up the inside of Rossi? He has. Max Biaggi takes the lead. Rossi relegated to second. He keeps his line, Max Biaggi. He's made his move. Rossi relegated to second. 5 laps to go. Who's going to take the checkered flag? Rossi holds firm in second place. Closes right up behind his bitter rival. They come into the left. Now they will break into the left, into the start and finish. 5 laps to go. We look again. We saw it on board, and it's Biaggi that got up the inside of Rossi into the right-hander.
Just as he had done on previous occasions, and just as we expected him to try again, Biaggi, as we said several times, coming out of those Uncini corners on full lean, getting the extra power onto the back straight and using it to his advantage at the end of the straight. It's just a real test now of the Yamaha's ability. Because we can fully expect that Max Biaggi is going to lead the way. Whatever happens now over the next 5 laps, we can expect Biaggi to pull that move on Rossi and lead into turns 12 and 13, the two right-handers that come back into that last left-hander. And it will be a real test of the Yamaha stability under the brakes to see if Rossi can get back at him.
There are tyres, slick, hard front, slick, hard back for Max Biaggi. Biaggi leads the way as they go down the slight incline. I don't like to call it a hill. Through the left and right swoops before they break for these vital, vital right-handers.
Yeah, just seeing there the comparison between the tyres. Biaggi going for a hard rear and Rossi a medium rear. And that could be what's working in Biaggi's favour as well now at this late stage in the race. And Gav, we saw a couple of years ago with Toru Okawa, when he beat Valentino Rossi at this circuit, it was the tyre choice that was absolutely crucial, wasn't it?
Yeah, again, Rossi went for a kind of medium compound then, and Okawa went for a harder compound, but the difference on that occasion was they were dual compounds, and the right-hand side of Okawa's was harder. As I've said earlier,
Biaggi's run wide, and Rossi's looked to go through, but not quite. Sorry to interrupt you there, Gav, but it looked as though Biaggi left the door open, and for some reason, Rossi didn't accept the invitation.
Yeah, well, I think Max Biaggi, Mick was saying earlier that he'd seen him slide. I'm not sure how intentional that is. I'm not sure whether he is feeling problems with his tyres. I'm not sure whether that slide is coming because they're starting to get worn and it's starting to get a little ragged.
Biaggi trying to make the break with 4 laps to go. Up the hill through turns 2 and 3 before they're going to break for the right-hander. Turn 4 into the Dunlop curve. Biaggi still leads the way. Rossi right behind him. This is going to go all the way to the checkered flag. As I said, the 125s were decided on the last bend. The 250s on the last bend. This is going to be decided, I would imagine, on the last bend. We ride with the doctor. He's in second place.
Just a word for Loris Capirossi, who's made it up into sixth position now after a lot of problems for the Ducati. Seems to be coming better during this race.
Yep, Capirossi edging ahead of Colin Edwards. So disappointment for Colin Edwards. He expected a lot more from this opening round on the Honda. In MotoGP, Edwards down to 7th, Capirossi up to 6th, as you rightly said, Gav. But all eyes, with 4 laps to go, turn once again to this battle at the front. We'd like to tell you about the Ducati, we'd like to talk about the Suzuki and the Kawasaki, but there's just been nothing else to talk about but these two today. They've absolutely taken it to the MotoGP field. They've stretched out at the front. They've put on an absolutely incredible display of motorcycle riding, and it's been difficult to take our eyes off it, and even harder to think of anything else to talk about.
Dead right, and Rossi came out of those two right-handers into the back straight really fast then, and came very close up to the rear of Max Biaggi, as if to say, right, I'm sizing you up to do that. Perhaps on the last lap, perhaps on the penultimate lap, we will wait and see. They cross the line. 3 laps to go of this incredible opening encounter in the 2004 MotoGP World Championship. Sete Gibernau, a very lonely third place, but 16 very valuable points for the Spaniard who won the race here last year.
Yep, Chibber now knows it's a long championship, but you won't want to be playing second fiddle to these two for very long, because these guys are going to be at it all season. There's Michel Well, I was going to say Michel Fabrizio. I could have sworn we saw him in the box earlier on watching the TV, but a back marker moves out of the way and lets Biaggi and Rossi through.
Rossi's really closed up this time. I wonder if he's going to try and have a go at him at the end of the straight, as Biaggi did to him.
That is Michel Fabrizio there. He must have gone back out just to get some testing time in on that WCM machine.
Perhaps
got
right.
Sick of watching it on the TV. It's
right.
A bit of a surprise.
Get back out there. Right, 2.5 laps to go. Something's got to give. Biaggi leads the way, but Rossi is very, very close indeed. They come onto the back straight. Is Rossi close enough to try and outbreak him from sixth gear down into fourth, down into third? No, he's not. Biaggi just holds firm. Rossi very, very close indeed. Biaggi runs it wide an inch. Rossi will be through, but there's no way through at the moment for the Yamaha rider. It tightens up. Rossi goes through. There was an inch, and Rossi's done it, and there's nothing Biaggi can do about it. They break for the left-hander. Rossi just a little bit out of shape, but somehow he hangs on to the Yamaha. They come back into the start and finish area. 2 laps to go. Valentino Rossi leads, but Max Biaggi comes right up alongside him, tries to get up the inside of him in turn one and doesn't do so.
A big question answered there, Nick. We know Max Biaggi can take the advantage at the end of the back straight. The question was, can Rossi react? He's done it previously in the race. He's done it once again. That Yamaha is stable and it's nimble, and Rossi is using it to get the best out of every available inch on this circuit. There didn't look to be a space there to get through, but boy did he do it. Sensational stuff from the world champion.
1.5 laps to go. Rossi leads at the top end of the circuit. Max Biaggi in second place. Shibanov, Barros, Hayden and Caparossi. But Rossi. All eyes now, all eyes in the world, I think, focused on this battle at the front. Can Rossi amaze everybody by bringing Yamaha a victory here in the opening round of the championship? He'd be the first rider ever to have back-to-back victories in Grand Prix racing on different machinery. The first rider since the late Barry Sheen to win 4 consecutive opening rounds of the title. But this race is in no means over yet.
Rossi runs it wide, and we're watching him get out of shape now on this Yamaha. We saw him slide it a couple of times on that previous lap. He's really looking supreme. And you have to say, Nick, if what you're saying doesn't put it into context, what Valentino Rossi's doing here, then maybe this will. Yamaha haven't taken a pole since Valencia in 2002. They haven't had victory since Malaysia in 2002. They haven't won a title since Wayne Rainey back in 1992. And the highest championship position last year was Carlos Checa in 7th place. And Valentino Rossi is making it look as though they've been there forever. At the front of this MotoGP field, he's looking in control now with 1 lap to go. It's the final lap of the opening round of the season. And has Rossi got enough of an advantage over Max Biaggi as they sweep up through this section that takes them up towards the Dunlop corner, this tight right-hander, turn 4. Rossi opening up a slight advantage now. It's up to Max Biaggi now to come through the Dunlop, up the straight towards the boot, and then back down through this sweeping S section to get back in touch with Rossi so that he can try and make that move again, coming out of Uncini, onto the back straight and into that fast right at turn 11.
I think Rossi's done it. I think he's opened up a big enough advantage. I don't think Biaggi's going to be close enough. He got safely through the second part of the boot corner where he made the mistake 2 years ago. Right, we're coming into these right-handers any moment now. We go left and right and then into the right. This is crucial. I don't think Biaggi is close enough. I think Rossi can get here through here successfully and quick. He is going to cause a sensation by winning the race. They're on the back straight for the last time. 160 miles an hour before they break for the fourth gear right-hander. Rossi is going to do it. The 25-year-old Italian is going to write another chapter into the MotoGP history books. Can you believe it? Rossi is going to win the Africa's Grand Prix here at Melcombe, riding a Yamaha. Biaggi closes. He's not close enough. One bend to go for the world champion. Rossi is going to do it. The checkered flag beckons the doctor. The checkered flag is shown. Valentino Rossi wins the Africa's Grand Prix from Yamaha and from Max Biaggi.
Sete Gibernau takes an excellent third place on the Honda, but you have just seen history in the making. The first man ever to win consecutive races on different machinery, and he rightly gains the respect of his great rival Max Biaggi, who shakes hands with him. Sito Pons knows that his rider gave it everything. He set the fastest lap of the race on the final lap, Max Biaggi, to try and get close to Valentino Rossi, but he just couldn't get close enough, and Rossi hung on to take that historic victory. What a sensational performance. We're on board with him now, and I'm he's got a celebration lined up. He's absolutely exhausted. He can hardly believe it. And I tell you what, Nick, it almost looks as though he may be in tears.
I think he may be in tears. I really do think, in fact, this is no ruse. This is no joke. I just don't think he can believe what he has done. And wasn't it fantastic as he kisses the fairing of the Yamaha to see him and Max Biaggi shake hands so warmly? I think perhaps the rivalry is over now. They both just got such enormous respect for each other. You can talk for years, you can talk for days about who is the greatest motorcycle racer in the 55-year history of Grand Prix racing. This man surely must be him.
Well, they say you can't compare riders from different eras, but the likes of Agostini, who I'm sure is watching this from his house in Italy, and the late Mike Aylward, who I'm sure is watching it from the best seat in the house, would all agree that Valentino Rossi takes some licking. And I tell you what, if he said that yesterday qualifying on pole position was one of the greatest moments of his career, then this somehow has topped it. And Rossi celebrates his finest moment yet.
There is absolute mayhem in the Yamaha pit. You wouldn't believe. Lynn Jarvis jumping in the air, the director of Yamaha in Europe. Jeremy Burgess as well, fist in the air. No one expected this when Valentino Rossi joined Yamaha in January. When he came, he did the first test in Sepang. Who would have thought that they'd be out here winning the first race of the season? I've never seen Jeremy Burgess smile so much in my life, even when they won the title in the past.
Yeah, there could be a couple of Castle Lagers in the pump tonight for Jeremy Burgess and his crew. He only left one of them behind. Dick Smart decided to stay at Honda and work with Alex Barros, but he took the rest, the likes of Axel Briggs with him, that established technical backup team that took Mick Doohan to so many titles with Honda and Valentino Rossi to 3 titles with Honda. They all decided to follow him. They knew what a great talent he was, and they just couldn't bear to be apart with him. And you can see why he's such a joy to work with.
Here is Zito Pons talking to Max Biaggi. Of course they want to win the race, and that's one hell of a start of the season for Max Biaggi. And what a week, and what a roller coaster week it's been for Zito Pons with the loss of Antonio Cobas. And fans, I think it's probably some of the fan club, he's more excited than Valentino Rossi.
It is the fans club. He brings them to every race, doesn't he? A selection of them. I think there's about 11 of them here, or 12 here today. Rossi pays their airfares, brings them out, and they've really, really had an opportunity to celebrate and enjoy themselves in the South African sunshine. Gibbonau, the winner from last year, it wasn't to be for him today. An excellent performance from Alex Barros, really, to come through from ninth place and take fourth after getting a bad start from the third row of the grid. We've almost forgotten about the rest of the field. Across the garage there from Barros, Nicky Hayden in fifth place. Then further down, Capirossi sixth, Edwards seventh, Tamada eighth, Arbe ninth. Good performance from Arbe, the second highest Yamaha rider at the end. Checker 10th, Melandri 11th, Nakano 12th, Hopkins 13th, Bayliss 14th, and Shane Byrne, the MotoGP rookie, picking up his first MotoGP point in 15th place.
Prepare yourselves, back in pit lane, the doctor's arriving. He's just gone past our commentary box, actually. We could have reached out and banged him on the head and say, well done. Look at the reception he is getting.
There is Jeremy Burgess and that team. They've all worked so hard. They were used to finishing at 5 o'clock on a Friday afternoon, weren't they, Nick? And heading for the Nastro Azzurro hospitality tent. The Honda was so easy to set up, but they've been working hard this winter. They've been working extremely hard this weekend, and they've produced a bike that was worthy of a world champion and worthy of possibly the greatest motorcycle racer of all time. And he's just taken it to an historic victory in his first attempt here at the Pakisa Freeway. Quite stunning from Valentino Rossi, and even he didn't expect it. And you can see that there in the reaction of him and the rest of the team. Davide Brivio, technical director of the Yamaha team, came to Yamaha from Superbikes 2 years ago. He was a key member of the Yamaha push to get Valentino Rossi over to them, and he will celebrate this like nobody else tonight as well. Members of his catering crew in the background as well. His good friend Max in the blue, his chef, and they all went with him, didn't they? Yeah. There was nobody left behind, really.
There's a tear in the eye of Valentino Rossi of that, I'm sure. Just see him when he was hugging all his teammates through his helmet there. You could just see this is a special, special moment, not just for him, not just for Yamaha, but for the whole of MotoGP. Everything's been turned on its head with this victory from Valentino Rossi.
The quiet before the storm, one would imagine. We've got press conferences, we've got podiums, but then the biggest party welcome has ever seen will start. We salute a true world champion, a truly great sportsman, Valentino Rossi. And they're the three winning machines. Valentino's Rossi's Yamaha on the right, Max Biaggi's Honda in the middle, and the Honda of Sete Gibernau on the left. Yamaha are back in business. They're back in business due to one person only. 25-year-old Italian Valentino Rossi.
It's interesting to see Rossi's reaction, Nick. Very, very happy, but also quite serious as well, not clowning around in front of the camera like we may have seen him do in the past. And we said at the start of the race, he usually does that on the grid, but he didn't here either. He looks so focused, so determined, and now he just seems so exhausted and so satisfied with that victory that he's just struggling himself to take it in. The final results from the betandwin.com Africa's Grand Prix. Valentino Rossi winning in a time of 43 minutes, 50 seconds, 0.218. That's quicker than the race winning time last year of Sete Gibernau by a good 20 seconds. That just shows you how far he's come. Remember, Valentino Rossi struggled to stay with Gibernau in that race on the Honda.
Yeah, in second place, Max Biaggi. Third, Sete Gibernau. Four, Alex Barros. Five, Nicky Hayden. Six, Loris Caparossi. Seven, Colin Edwards. Eight, Makoto Tomada. Nine, good ride by Norik Abbey. 10, Carlos Checker. 11, Marco Melandri. 12, Shinya Nakano. Here we are, with coming up on the screen now. John Hopkins, Troy Bayliss, and Shane Byrne picking up the last point. Championship positions, the top, Valentino Rossi, 25. Biaggi, 20. Gibernau, 16. Barros, after a bad start, 13. Nicky Hayden, 11th. If that's what we're going to see for the rest of the season, book your seats, cancel your Sunday afternoons, forget going to church. Well, don't forget going to church, but forget going to church when MotoGP is on. Cancel that trip to the pub, because Grand Prix motorcycle racing, without a doubt, is the greatest motorsport on show at the moment. And it's due to this man, Valentino Rossi.
This was the race that did it. Valentino Rossi getting a great start, and it was so crucial, wasn't it? We said before that we've seen Rossi make bad starts and get involved in a fight in the field, but he was so determined to get away from pole position and set the pace at the front of this pack, and that's exactly what he did. And really, the rest of the field, other than Max Biaggi and Sete Gibernau, just couldn't cope with that pace.
Oh, didn't Max Biaggi try hard? He runs in a little bit wide, and suddenly Sete Gibernau comes into the equation, and they really get into each other's way a little bit and give Rossi an advantage. That's just what Honda didn't want to see. But Biaggi gets back in front of Gibernau and then really sets on this relentless pursuit of the Yamaha at the front. And he gets past Rossi once again.
Rossi fought back, though, didn't he? And it was in that section of the circuit where the race was decided, that fast right-hander where Biaggi seemed to have the edge and overtook Rossi so many times, and then the two tight right-handers followed by the tight left, where Rossi just used his genius and all his guile to get back past Max Biaggi. A crash there for Alex Hoffman on his the start of his full season, first full season in MotoGP. Carlos Checa got past his teammate Marco Melandri.
Once again, Biaggi got to the front, but Rossi was having nothing of it. He closed on his great rival, he left an inch, and he was through on the Yamaha. And then the checkered flag beckoned for a historic victory for the 25-year-old Italian, the king of MotoGP, Valentino Rossi.
Minutes, 50.218 seconds, that winning time, an average speed of 163 kilometres an hour. And as I said, that's 20 seconds quicker than Sete Gibernau's winning time from last year, which at the time as well was an outstanding effort from Gibernau, and one that Rossi had struggled to keep up with on his Honda. Switching to the Yamaha this year, as we said, can't really stress how much of a step that was, with Yamaha not having won since Sepang 2002, and no title since 92 with Wayne Rainey. Really just highlights the gravity of what Rossi's done and what he's doing, and you just couldn't have expected that performance from him today. You couldn't have expected him to go so much faster on the Yamaha than he did on the Honda last year. It's an absolutely incredible performance, and you just can't stress that enough.
The podium awaits Valentino Rossi, and I'm sure he's going to tell us this is the most important victory of a Grand Prix winning career. 125 world champion, 250 world champion, 500cc world champion, MotoGP champion on two occasions, switches to Yamaha, biggest switch ever probably in MotoGP racing. He goes out in the first race and he wins. The podium awaits the arrival of Sete Gibernau in third place, Max Biaggi second, and surely a cheer that will be heard all the way back in Italy with Valentino Rossi.
Africa's Grand Prix. In third place, please welcome Sete Gibernau.
Gibernau, welcome warmly by the paddock and the, 30 or 40,000 fans who've turned up here, 270 kilometres south of Johannesburg. It's a big trip wherever you come from in South Africa to the Free State capital of Welkom. But MotoGP has made it, MotoGP fans have made it, and Valentino Rossi has made it very special for everybody by winning the first round of the 2004 MotoGP World Championship, the betandwin.com Africa's Grand Prix.
The Constructors' Championship goes to Sakayeko Nakajima.
Oh, how Yamaha must be pleased to hear that name and that man coming onto the roster to receive the Constructors' winning championship. Now we wait for the distribution of the cups. First of all, Sete Gibernau.
Sete Gibernau.
Gibernau stood on the top step of the podium last year. He still carries that number 74 on his leathers of his late teammate, Daijiro Kato. Max Biaggi smiles. He knows he couldn't have done any more to stop this man, the winner of the Africa's Grand Prix and the early leader of the 2004 World Championship. Rossi starts his defence in perfect style with victory at Welkom.
The winner's national anthem will now be played.
He looks really reflective, actually, doesn't he, Valentino Rossi? I'm sure when the champagne arrives, things would change. But I think there were tears inside his helmet when he stopped and sat by the side of the bike. I don't think it was one of his famous Valentino Rossi jokes. I think he was absolutely overcome with emotion. We can forget that now, though, because the party's about to start. He's absolutely soaked in champagne by Sete Gibernau. Max Biaggi even joining in the fun. And there was a warm shake of hands, wasn't it, between Max Biaggi and Valentino Rossi. Both had given it absolutely everything. And Max Biaggi's day will come, I think, in this season. And I think he's going to push Valentino Rossi very, very hard for the title. I think we all hope so as well.
Yeah, I think it was reluctant but respectful, wasn't it, the handshake between them. Biaggi doesn't like losing more than any other Grand Prix racer, and especially not to Valentino Rossi. But you can't help but raise your hat to this guy. And Biaggi knows that.